All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. I want to thank you all for coming out on a Wednesday evening to participate in this panel discussion about criminal justice reform in South Carolina. My name is Megan, and I'm a reference librarian here for the public library system. And to give you a little context as to why we're having this program, we're participating in a larger initiative with a lot of organizations, including the Avery Center, College of Charleston, et cetera, and what is called the Race and Social Justice Initiative. And a really well-known lawyer from Alabama named Brian Stevenson, who is the executive director of the Equal Justice Initiative, is actually going to be speaking at the Satilli at the end of this month. There are some flyers in the back about it. I encourage you to take one and attend. And anyway, you know, we were thinking here, how can we engage in a dialogue about our criminal justice system in South Carolina? And so I reached out to these panelists, who I'm very thankful to have, to see if they would, you know, basically come and talk about their experience and their knowledge. And what we'll do first, before we get into the questions, is have each of our panelists just give a brief introduction and maybe a little information about why, you know, they're here and why they're participating in this panel discussion. So if you'd like to start with.
Hello, my name is Joe Darby. I am here wearing a couple of hats. One of them is a clergy hat. I served as a pastor for about 35 years, the last 14 of those in Charleston. I'm now what's called a presiding elder, which is basically a middle manager of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. In that capacity, I most definitely interact on behalf of members of the congregations that I pastored with the criminal justice system, helping folks to navigate their way, counseling with families and such. For the first 14 years of ministry, I was bivocational, so I was actively involved because I was a juvenile probation counselor in Richland County. In addition to that professional experience, I am the media past board chair for the South Carolina Civil Liberties Union, which takes a major role in sentencing reform, and I am still presently the first vice president of the Charleston branch in the ACP, which also takes an active interest in what happens in the criminal justice system.
I guess we'll just go down the line. I'm Susan Dunn. I'm the legal director for the ACLU of South Carolina. I've held that position or something comparable to that position since 2009. I have been a lawyer in private practice in South Carolina, or actually even in Charleston, since 1977. So I've been doing this for a while. The ACLU is committed to reducing mass incarceration and is part of an ambitious national campaign whose goal is to reduce incarceration in the United States by 50% within the next 10 years. So that's it's ambitious, but it's doable. And if you don't set a goal, you don't have anything to aim for. So we're working on that with all of the other affiliates. In South Carolina, the ACLU participated in the recent sentencing reform process, which took place 2009 and 2010. We've also been actively involved in issues involving juvenile justice, and we continue to be the place where prisoners across the state bring their complaints. There is no prisoner clinic in South Carolina, which is really unfortunate, so we have no way to really provide good resources for people with legitimate complaints within the prison system. But we do make sure we gather those complaints, and we actually report the complaints anonymously, of course. The categories of complaints, the kinds of complaints, and whether same guards are mentioned to Department of Corrections every year. So this is, it's an issue that's close to our institutional heart and something I'm honored to be here to speak with you about tonight.
Hello, my name is David Taylor. I'm a convicted felon, and I spend the vast majority of my life in and out of prison. And just recently, I just got involved with Ms. Amy Barge in the Turn and Leave Project. And it helped me turn my life around. It helped me to be a better person, a better man, a better father. And my thinking ain't the same. And it just a lot of things, a lot of tools, and the guidance that I got from this program that will open doors and help others like me who spend the majority of their life in and out of prison, in the streets, and involved with gangs and drugs. And the Turn and Be Project, along with Amy, just opened doors, opened my mind, opened my heart, and made me realize the things that I was doing, not only to myself, but to my family and the community as a whole. And it opened me up to realize that I'm a better person than the life I used to live, the things that I used to do. And without this program, I wouldn't be able to sit here on this panel today. This need to be addressed through a program like this right here, how to help convict the felon, how to help people that really need help. Thank you.
And I'm Brucie Hendricks, born and raised here in Charleston. Thank you. Thank you, Megan, for including me. I'm delighted to be here today and share my experience. I started out as a federal prosecutor here in Charleston and was a prosecutor for 11 years. During that time, I prosecuted an array of offenses that occur in the federal court system, including but not limited to Ku Klux Klansmen who burned down the Macedonia Baptist Church in the Williamsburg AME Church. It's a sad time back in the mid-1990s, and churches were burning across the country, and I was the local counsel and worked with the Civil Rights Division out of Washington, D.C. to prosecute the Klan, and not only for burning churches, but also for shooting people in Columbia and so forth. That was probably my most satisfying work as a prosecutor. I also prosecuted bank robbers, Hell's Angels, and counterfeiters, and a little white collar crime. So a little bit of everything. After 11 years of trial work, I was appointed as a U.S. magistrate judge here in Charleston for an 8-year term. I had 2 terms, but I didn't quite finish my second term when I was nominated by President Obama to be a United States District Judge for the District of South Carolina, and I was confirmed by the Senate. That was 2 years ago. While as a magistrate, I was tasked with the job of creating the first federal drug court in South Carolina and one of the first federal drug courts in the country. They've been in the state system, as you'll hear, and we'll talk more about later, for many years, 25 years at least. Modeled our first federal drug court here in Charleston after the state drug courts because there were none to model in the federal system, and worked with some amazing people, Judge Irv Condon, et cetera, et cetera. Upon confirmation as a U.S. District Judge, and my docket is split between Greenville, Florence, and Charleston, we then expanded the program to Greenville, Florence, Columbia, so we're now statewide, so we're the only court in the country, to my knowledge, that has a statewide drug court system, and my focus has been on that, and we'll hear more about it in a little bit.
Thank you, guys. So before we open up for Q&A with you guys, I prepared a couple questions to ask the panelists, just to maybe get us thinking about, you know, and to give us a little context for what is happening in South Carolina. And you guys are free to answer however you want, whether or not, you know, you'd like to, just kind of an informal thing. So the first question is, between 1983 and 2009, South Carolina's prison population nearly tripled. However, since the passage of the Omnibus Crime Reduction and Sentencing Reform Act in 2010, there have been steady declines in our prison population. Does this data indicate we're moving in the right direction?
I would say we're limping in the right direction. Yes, there has been a reduction, but we've got a decade or so of damage to undo with incredibly long sentences. that still result in people being released, but being released even less able to reacclimatize into the community than they would have been because they've been in jail for so long that a lot of the humanity is sort of eroded, which is an understandable process. So we've stopped building it up in some ways, and some of the really harsh sentencing has been modified, and some of the things that resulted sort of in an automatic jail sentence are now being treated less harshly at the front end. But I would also say that while the prison is the Department of Corrections system, the jail systems are the systems run at home, and the populations in our jails have not really gone down. We continue to lock people up for very, very minor crimes, and to lock people up who can't pay fines. And while it's not a criminal issue to lock people up who are unable to pay child support, these are the people that are filling our jails and feeding our prison system.
I think we are moving in the right direction, finally. I think it's a bipartisan effort, and slowly though, as Ms. Dunn said, it's hard to reverse some of the situations that she's discussed. But the main reason I think we're moving in the right direction is because we've begun now to focus on at least some courts, and the federal court is now starting to head in this direction to focus on the real heart of the problem, rather than everybody thinking that locking people up and throwing away the key is necessarily the answer and going to solve the problem. The most endemic problem facing our criminal justice system is drugs. More than half of the federal prisoners in the United States are serving time for a drug offense, but only 13% are serving time for a violent offense. Nearly three-fourths of the population are nonviolent offenders with no history of violence. And I don't want to toot my own horn here, but the centrality of this problem, having been a prosecutor and been on the bench now for a number of years, is why it's so important and why my court is being developed as a federal drug court to address the root problem of so many drug-related crimes, and that is drug addiction. Through the many years, I've seen much of the crime that we have being fueled by addiction. And drug courts are rehabilitative programs that, interestingly, combine treatment, supervision, and judicial accountability as an alternative to prison. I'm partnering with the Medical University of South Carolina. They've got literally a world-famous addiction clinic here, and spoken to the doctors, and they come and give us advice from time to time and partner with us in some areas as best they can. And they would love to have the judicial accountability piece as part of their treatment piece. So it's an unusual marriage of treatment and judicial accountability that does work. And as I mentioned earlier, the state programs have been in existence for 25 years. The evidence shows, the statistics shows, that drug courts turn the recidivism numbers on their heads. We've looked up the facts on that, and whereas more than two-thirds of those released from prison will be rearrested within 3 years, 75% of those who graduate from drug courts will not be rearrested a similar period. And even when counting those who fail out of drug courts, the program still reduced recidivism by an average of 8 to 13 points, and the best programs cut it by 45%. Now, what's really interesting on top of that, recidivism provides for community, cutting recidivism numbers provide for community safety, because if the root causes of the criminal activity is addiction, if you can attack the addiction or reduce the addiction, you can reduce the recidivism. And if it's not treated in jail, which it's not very well, then they're just going to come back out and commit the same thing. But really interestingly for the taxpayers is the huge savings that these programs result to the taxpayers. Research shows that these programs save $2.21 in criminal justice spending for every single dollar invested. But when the community savings are taken into account, which includes health care, emergency room costs, social services costs for broken families, are factored in, the estimated savings rises to $27 for every dollar invested. So it's good for the taxpayer, and it's good for community safety. Of course, it's really good for the offenders or the participants, because they get healed, they get to go back into the community, and they get to become taxpayers and get to, their families are not destroyed in the process as well. So it's a win-win-win situation.
For me, speaking from a convicted felon, there's no rehabilitation or no programs in prison to help us get ready for society. There's nothing there. In prison, you just think of how to be a better prisoner, how to be a better criminal, you know? You don't, if there's nothing there, there's nothing that, that could put us where we need to be to get us ready for society. And this program like the Turn and Leaf Project, what it does is change a person's mentality, change your way of thinking. So therefore, you could get prepared and be ready for all obstacles, no matter how hard it is that comes your way. No matter if you can't get a job right then, you ain't gonna go right back to the street, you know? Because the programs teaches us that if we think, whatever we think, if we think positive, we're gonna get positive. You know, if we think negative, we're gonna do negative. It changes our behavior, you know, and strengthen us. But there's nothing that prepares someone who, even like Jack just said now, that within 60 to 90 days, he will be rearrested. And that's a fact. That's a fact, because there's no guidance, there's no tools, there's nothing to help you. I mean, you already got a big strike against you, convicted felon. No, that's how I see it.
And I would just like to call attention to the fact that the state system and the federal systems are not the same systems. There have been a lot of changes within the federal system that have not trickled down to South Carolina. There's a clemency program in the federal system that allows people who are in for certain nonviolent offenses to petition to get their sentence lowered. We don't have anything like that here. There's a clear prohibition against solitary being used for juveniles in the federal system. We do not have that here. We have juveniles who have people who were convicted as juveniles who are serving life sentences, who we still haven't figured out a process for that to be reviewed, even though legally we must. So it's a slow kind of process, but the federal system is a lot smaller and a lot easier to change than the state system.
Sometimes,
yeah.
Y'all are way ahead of us in the drug court world.
And Lord knows what might happen with the next election, so there we go.
Do you guys have anything else you wanted to add before we move on to the next question? Okay. According to a recent study of criminal sentencing patterns conducted by the University of Sheffield, African Americans in South Carolina are consistently given harsher penalties than their white counterparts. Why is this?
Let me start with the recommendation of a reading assignment that Susan brought along. It's a book called The New Jim Crow. It's by Michelle Alexander. If you haven't read it, it's an excellent book. And she makes the case that what we're having now in the criminal justice system is just part of the evolution of American racism. She makes the case that from the time of the antebellum South, there has been a need, perceived need based out of fear and based out of economic necessity to exercise social control over black folk in general, and over black males in particular. During slavery, that was quite obvious by their property status. Following slavery, it was their sharecropper status that kept them in poverty, along with some lynchings and some Klan activity. Following Reconstruction is when you had American apartheid in place in the form of Jim Crow laws. Following the abolition of Jim Crow, you started to see a system where people suddenly started to get very tough on crime, very law and order oriented. And that law and order orientation came down hardest on the black community. And it's partially a product of race, it's partially a product of prejudice, it's partially a product of poverty. It starts with policing. I have been in that system for a while, early in my early years, and I saw some young people get diverted away into pretrial intervention programs. They were invariably white, and some young people who would get sent off to court for the same reason most often were African American. Sometimes it comes down to legal representation and the context of those legal representations, so that if you have the money to afford a good lawyer who can convince somebody you suffer from affluenza, you can get away with murder. It goes to sometimes being a problem of relationships, particularly in small towns like those in my present presiding elder district. I was meeting with the sheriff about a young man who was in jail for reckless driving, which was a dubious charge, a young black man. We were meeting at a restaurant in the small county, and while we were meeting, a lady came by to thank him for turning her son loose after he had just about outrun the police. And the sheriff just said, boys will be boys, and then turned back to the conversation as if he didn't see the parallel. It is a product of poverty, and it is a product of the free market as well. If you are poor and you are fined and you are not able to pay your fines, you go to jail. It's the equivalent of debtor's prison. It also feeds a prison industrial complex. There are prisons that are traded, private prison companies that are traded on the stock exchange, and they do quite well. But they cannot do quite well if they do not have a population. The way that you have a population is to make sure that there's somebody to go to those prisons. And the recent the drug laws that are starting to be changed, thank God, were a good way of making sure that that population stayed high. It also goes to public perception. You know, it's ironic that today you have presidential candidates running around talking about how we have to do something in the way of rehabilitation because of the heroin epidemic, this sweeping America. They're all emphasizing counseling and understanding because a lot of those heroin addicts are young suburban folks who can no longer get prescription drugs and they turn to heroin as the next option. Same folks who were ready to survive people 10, 15 years ago for crack cocaine. All of those things play into the difference. America has come a distance in terms of race, but we still have a very, very, very long way to go. End of sermon.
And I think the particularly the study that you reference is a study that was done by academics in Canada who just picked South Carolina because the judges in South Carolina have more latitude than judges in a lot of places in terms of sentencing. And you know, some of my best friends are judges. You know, these are not people that I think sit on the bench and deliberately try to be harsher on African American people than white people. It ends up that if you study what happens, it was sort of unconnected with personality, it's pretty clear that does happen. Do we really know the reasons why it happens? I don't know that we do. But I think we're beginning to realize that those reasons you know, are real, but complicated. But their complication doesn't make them any less real. For example, there is a real sense, and I've heard this more from family court judges really than from circuit judges, that when they lock someone up, if they lock a child up who has, you know, failed to do what they were supposed to do in a probation order, for instance, the judges feel like they're rescuing the child if it's a black child who lives in poverty. And they really think that if they don't do something, they don't pay attention to this child, nobody else is going to, and that the judicial system is a way to do that. That may have good intentions, but it has really bad collateral consequences. Because locking up a child, even for a short period of time, is the thing that's most likely to predict that that child will not finish high school and that that child will then be in the adult criminal system, you know, even just for a weekend. So the rescuing, that desire to rescue, may be doing a whole lot more harm than it is helping. And I think that there is still percolating within many of our imaginations the notion that a black man is just simply more dangerous than anybody else we're going to run into. And therefore, if you're making a decision based upon, I'm going to lock this person up because of public safety, there's a larger public safety risk, even if the person standing in front of them is accused of exactly the same crime as a white person. These are realities that we have to live with and we have to figure out how we're going to grow beyond. But until we face them and own them honestly, we're not going to be able to do anything that will change them.
Well, if y'all have been watching the news, and I bet you have, it's clear that these issues are really getting some traction right now, finally. And there's a dialogue at the state and federal government levels about how to remedy some of the imbalances. I'm looking at a statistic now from the Sentencing Project, from the Bureau of Justice statistic. For all men, the lifetime likelihood of imprisonment is 1 in 9. For white men, it's 1 in 17. For black men, it's 1 in 3. For Latino men, it's 1 in 6. For all women, it's 1 in 56. For white women, it's 1 in 111. For black women, it's 1 in 18. And for Latina women, it's 1 in 45. So there are clear imbalances. But this is a really hard issue because the incentive to harsher punishment and penalties are often all pointing in one direction, which is lock them up first and ask questions later. The community wants safety. And anything that speaks to that part of their need encourages political support for harsher and harsher penalties. And that's why it's so critically important that in forums like this that we educate folks on the things we're talking about tonight to make sure that we address problems at their root without sacrificing community safety. I don't know if y'all know anything about federal criminal sentencing, but it's really a pretty unusual process. It's called the guideline sentencing process, and it was created by the United States Sentencing Commission, which basically created an empirical tool. And just a very brief primer on it. Essentially, this just gives the judge a recommended range of sentencing options. The judge can depart from the recommended range, but if she's going to depart, he's going to depart, he needs to justify that departure because it might be appealed. That's a little nitty-gritty on the mechanics of sentencing in the federal system, but it's kind of necessary to understand that the output of a particular sentence in federal court on a particular case is not so easily narrowed down to one judge's decision. For example, you could have two offenders plead guilty to the exact same crime or set of crimes, but they could be in totally different sentencing ranges in federal court to begin with due to factors like previous criminal history, aggravating and mitigating factors related to the current offense, cooperation with the authorities, and the list goes on. And so it's really not a simple matter in the federal system, but things are gradually turning towards the better, and we do have the authority to vary downward, but we just have to have a good basis to do it.
All right, the next question is on either the state or federal level. Is there any pending or new legislation we should know about as it pertains to criminal justice reform?
what, it's not exactly legislation, but in Charleston, I think we should really be watching the initiative that the County Justice Council has done, and Ashley is here, is on that. And there is a group in Charleston that's really looking at making some substantial changes in our criminal justice system that could make a real difference. And it would only make a difference sort of within Charleston County, but it could be a model for the rest of the state. It depends upon getting funding, but it would put in place, you know, several things, and I'm not going to tell you all of them, but some of them that would make a real difference. Is one, having some clear guidelines for a police officer as to whether someone should be arrested for a minor offense. At this point, it's just left to the police officer's discretion. And so sometimes, you know, a police officer will lock somebody up for an open container just because the police officer's frustrated about something else. You know, or the police officer may lock someone up just because it's the third time the same person has been confronted by this police officer for simple trespass. But this project would put some objective standards in place that would remove it from the police discretion, which would cut down on that initial incarceration. The project would also make it so that the lawyer would be available at the bond hearing, so people would have representation before the bond hearings. Now, frankly, that's required by the Constitution anyway, but we don't have it here, and we don't have it in most places in South Carolina. And again, having a lawyer available at the bond hearing would also cut down on a fair amount of incarceration, because there's some issues that can be brought up at a bond hearing that often aren't brought up because there's no one there who knows that this should apply to that particular defendant. So those are things that would actually make a difference in incarceration, and I would encourage you to watch to see if the grant funding comes in, and then to support those actions to make the changes in Charleston. But other things that are happening statewide is there is a piece of legislation moving through the state legislature that would raise the age for juvenile offenders, so that instead of it being, you know, below 17, it would move it to be below 18, which would actually make, it doesn't seem like that would make a large difference, but it would make a significant difference, both in how those people are adjudicated, and also the ease in which offenses could then be expunged if the person, even if they're found delinquent, could move on with their lives and have a second chance. Senator Malloy is really pushing that bill, and if you have the opportunity to speak to the legislature and support that, I would encourage you to do so. There's also been a statute introduced in both in the Senate and the House to modify the disturbing school statute, which is the statute that it's the second most common referral to the juvenile justice system is the charge of disturbing school, which is a completely nonviolent crime, and is used as a way to really feed the school to prison pipeline. When I say used as a way, it's not really, I'm sure it's not anybody's real intention, but it does have that effect. This, the modification to the disturbing school would make it so that a student could not be charged with that offense in their own school. So they couldn't be used against students in their own school. It involves some other kinds of things that would also clarify what it means. But that also is an important thing that is coming up. And there's also, I don't know if it's actually going to get traction this legislature because it's a little bit complicated, but there is a movement to revise the expungement statute to make it so that once somebody has, you know, completed everything that they were supposed to do, that they have an opportunity to clear their record so that they then have opportunities for education and for housing and for employment that sometimes they're barred for the rest of their life, you know, simply because they've got to check the box that they were convicted. So there is a move to expand people who are eligible for expungement, and I again would suggest that people support that if you have the opportunity to.
Sure. Susan's highlighted some key things in the state courts and state legislature. I'd like to tag on a little bit to that. Back in 2010, our state passed the Omnibus Crime Reduction and Sentencing Reform Act, Senator Gerald Malloy, who she just mentioned, spearheaded that, and that act modified dozens of sentencing policies on the state level. It improved parole-making decision, it strengthened community supervision, and required legislative oversight and accountability. There have been some interesting numbers since then. That was 2010. As of 2015, the changes that have been made pursuant to that act have cut the state's daily prison population by more than 9% to 22% below the projections. It increased probation and parole completion rates by 12 and 9% and closed 2.5 prison facilities. And let me tell you, that saves a lot of money. It is expensive to house and incarcerate prisoners in both the state and federal system. And very interestingly, this hasn't come at the cost of public safety. In South Carolina, the violent and property crime rates actually fell by 16 and 7%. And here we have closed 2.5 prisons, respectively, between 2010 and 2013. As of August of 2015, the new law had saved the state at least $18.7 million, with additional cost savings coming out of avoiding projected prison population increases. Senator Chip Campson said that this approach is soft on the taxpayer and smart on crime. It's soft on the taxpayer because it'll reduce the need to build more prisons. It's smart on crime because community-based alternatives such as restitution, turning leaf, and drug courts entail more actual accountability by the authorities and have been proven to reduce recidivism. And Senator Malloy, who chaired the Oversight Committee, which monitors implementation of the act, indicates that that it has made a tremendous difference on the state side. On the federal side, our Congress, the U.S. Congress, is beginning to see the positive trends in states like South Carolina and is attempting to emulate efforts. There's some proposed bills in Congress that would focus federal corrections resources on only the most serious offenders. There's the Charles Colson Task Force on Federal Corrections, and that was established in 2014. This task force is designed to learn from the experience of the various state sentencing and corrections reform efforts and to develop data-driven policy recommendations to ensure federal prison is reserved only for the most serious offenders and ensure that offenders, and this is key, are provided the support and supervision needed to become productive and law-abiding citizens again, thus reducing recidivism and allowing gentlemen like Mr. Turner to become taxpaying citizens and contribute to their families and their communities. These goals can be accomplished, is proven, in that they both enhance public safety and conserve public dollars. So we need to encourage our legislators on the state and federal level to keep it up.
So that kind of leads into the last question I have before we open it up. We've already kind of talked about this some, but what else can we do in this state to support criminal justice reform?
Making the assumption that everybody here wants to do that, there are about two or three things that you can do. One of them is be obnoxious. People in Congress and people in the legislature, those who set policy, are effective when they hear from their constituents, whether they agree with their constituents or not. When you call, when you write, when you're persistent in doing that, it makes a difference. When you go to town hall meetings, public hearings, make your voice heard, you make a difference. If you talk to a lot of people who are in elected office, they know some citizens very well. They hate to see them coming because they know that they're going to say something. And it makes a difference when that happens. It's even better when you're obnoxious and organized at the same time. There are groups like the NAACP, like the ACLU, like the League of Women Voters. They can always use volunteers as well as financial support groups that enable you to get the people of like mind to make a difference. It helps when you do that. I give a particular plug to the Charleston Area Justice Ministry, which is going to have a massive assembly, I think, on this coming Monday. Each year that ministry selects, I think there are 20 or 30 member houses of faith now, but they select an issue each year. and they have evolved this year to the issue of criminal justice and race, and they're going to be making some recommendations to local law enforcement. And they usually do well because they're quite well organized. They have people from all of those houses of faith, and so chiefs of police, especially elected officials who can count votes, are pretty much affected when 2,000-3,000 people say, we have agreed that you need to do this. What do you think you need to do? So when you organize like that. And thirdly, go to the polls every single chance you get. A very good federal judge who's sitting up here was an Obama administration appointee. Presidents appoint federal judges. Legislators elect judges in South Carolina. We have to make sure that we elect people with good sense. When we do that, they in turn will promote policies that have good sense and will promote people who have compassion and vision to the judiciary.
I'd say ditto to all that, but I won't repeat it all. There's some other practical things that I think regular people can do that can have significant effect on the criminal justice system. And one is, one great place to start is with school discipline. It's kicking our kids out of school and into the criminal system where all of this starts. And that's where black boys get singled out to begin with. They get suspended and expelled at a much higher rate in South Carolina schools than anybody else. And wherever your kids go to school or your neighbors go to school, you should be interested in that issue, and you should be always asking, and you should always, always know that keeping a kid in school is much better than kicking them out. And that we need to have the resources and the ways to meet the children's needs in an educational situation, not in a judicial situation. Also toward that end, Charleston particularly is embarrassing in the fact that it really has no community-based alternatives to incarceration for kids. You know, in many communities, if a child is not able to succeed in probation, they can be referred to a mentoring program. They can be referred to a job program. They can be referred to an after-school program. They can be referred to this and that. And we have just not developed those. Talk to your community groups. Talk to your churches about the possibility of you being a place where those things could happen. And the other is that you live in a world where people that you know, if not yourself, hire people. They rent apartments to people. They do all kinds of things. And if I can encourage you to not be one of those people who feels like, you know, a convicted felon has a big scarlet A on their head for the rest of their lives. If you take a risk on some of these people, you will have a friend forever. You will actually have a loyal employee. You will have a good landlord. You be able to make informed decisions. You know, somebody who had a felony conviction for misuse of a credit card 15 years ago and has no other crime is not a risk as an employee necessarily, not a risk as a landlord. And we need to get away from that kind of fear-based stuff and look at the real people in front of us and make choices. You know, it's not wrong or a big risk to give those people a chance. And to encourage the people you know that hire people to do that. Those things will do a lot in terms of making this not such a consistent cycle of not being able to reintegrate into the community.
Rehabilitation programs like drug court, programs like the Turning Leaf Project. Those are the things that I see that could make, and the community getting involved, the government getting involved, helping convicted felons so when they do get out, businesses could hire, would take that chance to give us the opportunity to prove ourselves. I'm gonna let y'all know something real quick. I did time in prison, starting from drugs to murder. And where I work at Santee Cooper now, and the director of who I work with, we sat down and we talked. And I told him what all I was locked up for, the thing that I done did. And he told me straight up that if I came to him for an interview, that he wouldn't hire me. So if it wasn't for turning leaf, I wouldn't have had the job. But guess what he tell me now? I'm glad that you're here. Because my performance and my dedication and the progress that he see I've made since I came and worked for him. So it's things like rehabilitation, it's things like programs, the community giving us a chance, businesses giving us a chance. Because like you said, we got a scar on us for life. But given the opportunity to prove ourselves with the right tools, with the right guidance, we can make it. We can make it. But it's going to have to be everyone get together and not chastise just because he's a convicted felon or she's a convicted felon or she's black or she's white. Not chastise for these things. With the right opportunity, with the right guidance, with the right tools. Like you said, you need a best friend for life.
I agree with David and Susan that and what I've seen in our program is most importantly is we've had people there to encourage the participants and to remind them that they were not their mistakes and they're not a label given to them by the system, and to actually speak hope to them. And when they hear that from positions of authority, it seems to really give confidence to them. And it's also very important to get the community involved. We've had people from the community and our courthouse family get deeply involved with our program and actually mentor participants, help them find jobs, help them find housing, and help them find transportation. And we even had one very successful local attorney who was so moved by the story of one of our young participants who had completed our program that he's actually helping to pay for her to go to college. I think it's important for all of us to resist the temptation to embrace so-called tough on crime rhetoric. That's not to say that we don't want our law enforcement officers and our prosecutors to be effective and for the courts, state and federal, to hold offenders accountable, but it's too easy to have a knee-jerk reaction and think that locking everybody up is going to solve the problems that we have with crime. Instead, we need, and you need, to be focused on understanding and addressing the root causes of the crimes, what I said in the very beginning here today. Drug and alcohol addiction, instability in families, lack of education, and while I'm on the subject of education, I think we need early childhood public education available for everybody in this world, lack of employment, and so forth. It's not been politically viable for our leaders to encourage us to be smart on crime or intelligent on crime. They know that it's more advantageous to present themselves as being tough on crime. And this is true of both Democrats and Republicans at all levels of government. But the political viability of this message begins with you, and it begins with the public being willing to start thinking critically about these issues. We need to use problem-solving courts as a way to connect the public, the way to connect you with people like David who are struggling to get clean, struggling to stay clean, and struggling to put their lives back together. I think one of the key reasons our drug court in Charleston has been successful is community involvement. And I think community involvement in education and a willingness to think critically is key.
Okay, so we have about 30 minutes before we'll do closing remarks. So if anybody has a question or a comment,
yes, my name is Mr. Moultrie. By the way, I have a... I wrote in an op-ed to the Pulse and Courier. It might be out in the next couple of days. Last name is Moultrie. One of the things that I touched on was felony convictions in terms of punishing people with a felony history. If we were in a kindergarten and they would set the laws, I don't know if a person that's 5 years, 6 years old would see that punishing someone a second time is ridiculous, absurd. What I want to say though is that I was almost a gray in Baltimore. In the 80s, I traveled from Massachusetts as a student to Baltimore on the bus. Went to visit my cousin, and she lived in a project house. Knocked on the front door. They said she don't live there. I went to back, knocked, and I left. About a bunch of police, 7, 10, 8, whatever, blasted out of the backyard, told me what I wanted, asked me what I wanted. I said, I'm a traveler. I'm coming from Massachusetts. I'm coming to see my cousin. And they said something to me. I said something back. They threw me in the paddy wagon. I was in jail for the weekend. The Monday morning they came about, the judge told me to get out of Dodge because police officer said that I used nothing but profanity to him. That's why they arrested me. But I was in a state penitentiary for a whole weekend. So I was almost a Freddie Gray in Baltimore. But again, there's an op-ed I wrote to the Post and Courier, a last name Moultrie, and I talked about that along with a lot of other stuff. Thank you.
Ask about what you were saying about school discipline. I'm a ninth grade teacher at Fort Dorchester High School, and I've been teaching for a pretty long time now. And you know, again, I was just thinking, as you were talking about not just throwing kids out of school, I was thinking how many times I've been guilty of thinking, oh, this kid is finally gone. You know, this bad kid is finally gone. We don't have to deal with him anymore. And again, I'm not going to say that we should just be chucking kids out because none of you understand how hard it is to deal with them on a daily basis, but. My question is, you know, is there anything in place for these parents that, you know, it seems to me that the general generational wave seems to be that many parents, especially parents of color, have been failed by the school system, have been let down by the school system, especially, unfortunately, down here in the South. And so they truly believe on a fundamental level that school is not really the place to be. School is not the place where you need to be focusing your attention. And a lot of parents are very quick to be defensive. They're very quick to take the side of their child. And I was just wondering, when you have children that are starting to enter into the system, what is exactly in place for parents who are maybe, you know, weren't taking proper steps when it was at the school level and now it's become a serious legal problem? You know, when we can't get them to talk to us, we can't get them to come to meetings, we can't get them on the phone to talk to administrators, and they outright refuse to even take part in the disciplinary process. And we pretty much have to do it all without them. And so, you know, is there any way we can hold parents to be more accountable for their kid? I mean, you know, I say it all the time to my coworkers. I'm like, just because you feed it and keep it alive doesn't mean you're raising it. It's not a plant. You know, it takes more than that to raise your kid. And so I was just thinking, especially with parents of color who have, like you said, these young black boys, which I see day in and day out, are always the ones getting targeted, always the ones getting kicked out. What do we do for these parents who are either unwilling or incapable of having these conversations that need to be had?
I think there's a need for partnerships. And I say that as a husband of a retired teacher who was in a kindergarten classroom for roughly 30 years. Children at the beginning of the year who could not pronounce their names and have them doing poetry by mid-year. One of the schools that she worked at in Charleston County School District, regular plain old garden variety public school, C.C. Blaney Elementary, through for one school year had a sum total of 3 suspensions. No expulsions, 3 suspensions. It's because when the time came to talk with parents, the teachers were encouraged to go out and talk to them if need be. When the time came for parents to come in, the principal at that school demanded mutual respect between parent and child. And she recognized that some of her parents had had poor school experiences. So she worked actively to build that up in a different direction so the parents were more amenable and more a part of the system. The principal before her terrorized that school because that principal, when the child was misbehaving, would routinely, from what she told me, call the parent and say, your child needs an individual education plan. You're gonna come in and do that with us. If you don't, we're gonna call the police and charge you with neglect. So I think it goes to a partnership between parents and teachers and looking at creative ways to go out of the box, find new ways to build lines of communication and mutual respect. I have seen that work in that school. I've seen that work in other schools. And I say that too, as a parent of two sons, the youngest of which was as tall as me when he was in the sixth grade, and who was recommended for suspension once because the teacher said, today we're not gonna work on art. And he said, why? That was the only thing he did, but he was recommended for suspension. Right. So I think when that mutual respect deals up, that helps.
Yeah, and I'm not about to say that they're easy answers. I'm just saying that criminalizing it is the wrong answer.
Right.
I think that we are learning that we have expected teachers to work miracles. I think we are also learning that many of our teachers, and I'm not saying this about you, but I'm just saying many of our teachers have received no training in discipline. They're just assumed to know how to do it. and that's a kind of not a good assumption in this day and age.
Right.
And I think that we're still working on old models that make it seem like our kids are going to school and our teachers are teaching in communities where everybody's had kind of a similar experience. And one of the things that I described is that, you know, if you put a child down at a dinner table who's not used to a fork, not used to sitting at the table, not used to that phenomenon, that child is gonna look like misbehavior. When in fact, that child has simply never been taught, your fork goes here, you know, you sit, We you know, at our table, you know, we all sit still until everybody is, you know, whatever the rules are at the table, they're not things that come naturally to a child.
Right.
And I think a lot of the things that we ask kids to do in a school environment are similar to that they simply haven't learned the building blocks, not because they're bad and not necessarily because their family is bad. It's just simply because they haven't had the rules, they haven't learned those rules. And until they learn the rules, they're always going to fail.
Right.
And until they're explained the rules in a kind of a consistent fashion that begins to make sense, it isn't going to work. So it's just that's just, you know, a way of looking at it. But I think the another piece is that I think we have really, this is really going to diverge, but I think we've really underestimated what a horrible effect it has had on family life. To make it when people work full time that they don't make enough money to support their family. You know, if you gotta work two jobs, you know, you don't have time to come to school when the teacher calls.
Right.
And you feel badly because you can, and it pisses you off because you can, but it's just the reality.
Right.
And we are making people live lives that are unsustainable and that are not child friendly.
And you're not talking about teachers, though.
No,
right?
Well, no. I think teachers are.
We don't really have sustainable salaries either. So.
But we just, you know, with it's a whole lot of our community that doesn't get paid enough to live a sustainable life, and it's very hard to raise children when you don't have a sustainable.
Right. Let's go ahead and move on. We have a lot of questions.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh,
sure.
Yeah.
Thank you. I just had a quick comment in response to. Ms. Dunn, what you were saying earlier about there not being any alternatives to incarceration programs here in Charleston, there is actually one, and it's new as of this school year. It's Girls Drive Charleston, local nonprofit. They have started an after-school program for young girls and transgender youth who have been involved in the juvenile justice system. And they do a lot of great work, music education, community organizing, you know, learning the basics of that, and also political education and history to sort of give them an understanding of incarceration and the prison system, and sort of, you know, be able to think about themselves and their experiences in that context. So it is a really great organization, and if anyone is interested in, you know, something they can do to support, Girls Rock Charleston is a really good organization to look at.
Hi, I apologize for being a little nervous. My topic's a little uncomfortable. I think, you know, we're talking about the tough on crime mentality, and I think one of the ways that that plays out most vividly in people's real lives is the sex offender registry. It's easy for a lot of people to say, oh, sex offender, you know, they're messed up people, they don't deserve second chance, don't deserve life, anything. But when it's somebody you know, when it's your family and friend, the way that registry can affect your life is very it's harsh, I don't want to minimize the needs of victims at all, but the needs of offenders are real as well. And there's a lot of evidence to show that the registries, at least the public nature of the registries, does a lot more harm than good by preventing offenders from reassimilating into the community because of the residency requirements, difficulty of getting a job, and just the stigma and the psychological damage it does to those offenders and their families to have this burden carried throughout their whole life that's on the internet, public for everyone to see, that we for some reason don't have for other crimes. And it almost never gets talked about because it's such an uncomfortable topic. But I think it needs to be. I saw on there that there's like 3,000, over 3,000 people in the state who are like supposed to be on the registry, and there's a lot of data to show that these the laws that require the registries are being applied too broadly, and there are people on the registries that do not belong there. I think this is something that needs to be talked about, and I was wondering if you guys have any thoughts on it. And just one more thing to add, some of the stuff I've been reading from nationalrsol.org is actually saying that they believe that the sex offender registries are in major violations of 6 amendments of the Constitution, including the right to privacy. I mean, there's collateral damage for the family. You can have a cop show up at your house without warning several times a year. You might have company over. You just, you know, sign a thing saying that offender still lives there. And how do you explain that? Your guess, you know what I mean? I just think it's something that's really hard to get pushed through government, but there's got to be some reforms. And I was wondering if you guys had any thoughts on that. Thank you.
Registry works. She raises some interesting points that I think everybody in authority and the legislature should take a look at. You certainly don't need people on those kind of lists when they don't qualify for them. And so it's dangerous to set up things like that and then not have the process policed so that it's fair and it's appropriate for the offense. And I think that it is uncomfortable, but I think it was really courageous of you to bring it up, and that it's something that we should all think about. Susan, you know?
Yeah, well, and I will say that the all across the country, the ACLU is actually testing various portions of the sex offender registry and different kinds of restrictions. I do think that you know, part of the problem with the sex offender registry almost everywhere is that there is no mechanism for any kind of a review. You know, there's not any, like 10 years later you can come and ask for it to be lifted, or there's just nothing. It's just lifetime no matter what. And we've also sort of erred on the side of over-inclusiveness. And many of the sex registry laws came into effect after people may have pled guilty for something, you know, several years earlier, or maybe even when they were a kid. And then they find out that they've got to do this. And there's some, there are some serious problems, and I want to get into the kind of the legal niceties of it. But I think that it is important for the community to talk about it. And I think it's important for the community to honestly ask the questions of, if someone is guilty of statutory rape, you know, so it was a 19-year-old who had sex with a 15-year-old, who was his girlfriend, or, you know, whatever the story was. In many situations, that person is kept on a sex registry that's just as harsh to that person as someone who was a pedophile who had offended, you know, with 10 to 12 kids. You know, they're treated the same way. It's clear they're not the same crime. And it does seem to me we need at some point to be able to ask the questions of, is this registry actually making us safer? You know, is someone who was guilty of statutory rape more likely to create, to reoffend, when we don't ask somebody who you know, perhaps shot somebody. If somebody who's shot, you know, three or four people in their life, if they serve their sentence, you know, they're not on the not good with guns registry for the rest of their life. And I'm not, you know, again, I'm not trying to minimize the offense, but I do think that, you know, to a certain extent, America, bless its heart, you know, is really hung up on sex. And this is a way that acts out. And that until we're able to have community conversations about sex and to be able to address those kinds of things by really asking questions instead of just responding with horrified fear, you know, we're not going to get very far, you know, with dealing with that issue.
I know we had some questions over here.
This has to do with a recent case that was reported in the paper, and my two-pronged question. Does the punishment always fit the crime? This is about the young woman from Edisto, and then she died because of lack of medical care or inadequate medical care. It seemed to me, if our paper reported it right, that she stole a very small amount of goods, and the fine seemed way out of proportion, like $1,200 or $1,500 for $10 or $15 worth of candy bars being stolen, or something like that. So, do judges have a guideline to go by when they're dealing out fines? That's one question. And then, how do we get better medical care to people like this young woman?
I can't really speak to an active case like that right now. It wouldn't be appropriate as a sitting judge to do that. But I will say that there are guidelines, at least in our system, for fines and how to implement fines. Of course, all jails and prisons are responsible for the care of their inmates. So. But I really can't really speak about it much beyond that. It's just not appropriate for me to do it. But I'm sure Ms. Dunn can.
you know, there's so many problems with that story.
In case some people might not know, would you?
I can summarize the story. This was a woman who had struggled with addiction and lived in poverty on Edisto Island. Was in her mid-50s. And she had, I don't know whether she was convicted or pled guilty to stop shoplifting, it wasn't really clear, but she had a fine that she was given, and she had a payment plan. And she met the payment plan for about a year and then was just unable to do it. And when she was unable to complete paying her fine, the municipal court issued a bench warrant for her arrest. And the bench warrant was just sort of out there. And she knew that she had the bench warrant out, but she was just sort of living below the radar. She had gone to the hospital because she was sick. And as the story, you know, panned out, her son was very concerned that she was not dealing well with her life. And he actually told the sheriff's office that she was at the hospital because he thought that would get her help. So she was arrested from the hospital, taken to the jail, continued to have abdominal problems. And the people who were in the jail with her who described her as being continually vomiting. And eventually she died in the cell that she was in after she was there for a day or so. She did get checked on by a nurse, but she actually had an abdominal infection. She ended up being dehydrated because she wasn't getting water, but there was some assumption that she was just experiencing the DTs because there were people who knew that she was a heavy drinker, so that that's the story that resulted in her death. And when I say there are many, many things wrong with that, going back to the original conviction, while it wasn't ever part of what was reported, I would be willing to bet that she had no access to legal advice in that case. Because almost everybody who goes to a municipal or magistrate court who is poor and facing a criminal crime has no access. So that was the first problem, is not really knowing what you were getting into at the onset. You know, I would say also another problem, and this goes to what you're saying about the drug court, is how tragic that this is the way a son can reach out for help for his mother, that we have no other way to have resources for an indigent person to get help, that where you think going to jail is the best way to get treatment. I mean, clearly, that's a problem. But on the other hand, it may actually be true, that he actually had no other resource or didn't know that there was a way he could go to probate court and could ask for resources for her. But really, you know, even though we all know that if someone has a drug or alcohol problem, treatment is the way to deal with it, not jail, we really lock more people up than we have access for treatment, particularly poor people. So it's good to toot the treatment horn. And I'm happy that drug court gets some people in treatment, but we really as a community have not invested in treatment. We don't have enough variety of treatment, we don't have accessible treatment, we don't have affordable treatment. And until we do, we're not gonna make a difference in this problem. So there are all kinds of problems involved. And you know, obviously the problem of not having the medical treatment. But jail is not a particularly safe place. And you know, even when you do the best you can, it's very hard to make it safe. And locking up sick people is not a good plan. And it does seem to me also that if a hospital is releasing somebody, you know, to law enforcement, there's some obligation to give the law enforcement the information they need to have if they're taking custody of this person. It's just a lot of questions.
And law enforcement actually did give them the information that they needed. The lady had gastroenteritis, they passed her on the medication, they indicated that she should be, you know, hydrated if need be. And even though it says that she tried to drink water, her body just would not accept that. She should have had some intravenous hydration. That did not happen. And, you know, one of the things that's in the report that's still playing out is basically the jail saying, well, she didn't tell us she was having a problem. Well, if you are dehydrated to the point that you are approaching death, you might not realize that you have a problem. So there's a need for more compassion sometimes in situations like that. And again, there's a need for us to make sure that public institutions are public institutions, even jails. Sometimes private institutions cut unfortunate corners, and that was a private medical.
I saw some hands over here earlier. Did anybody else still have a question?
Can I project?
Sure.
If y'all can hear me. Judge, I know you spoke earlier about efforts in the drug court and the federal system. As a public defender, I saw many of my clients had mental health issues, and that led to criminal activity. Is there any effort in the federal system or any discussion in the federal system to take on programs like we have in Charleston County with mental health court or any programs that deal with you know, people's mental health issues in that system?
There's discussion, but not much has been done yet. What we're hoping is that with the drug courts, and we have started, some areas have started veterans treatment courts. and they deal a lot with mental illness. So that's trending in a good direction there, but not a per se mental health court system. But we're hoping that with the progress of the drug courts and the veterans courts, that these kind of programs will be discussed and implemented. This spring, actually, half of the federal judges in the United States are actually coming to Charleston, and they're coming to visit the drug court and to participate in a workshop on other subjects too. So we're hoping that the more judges see, the more they start thinking outside the box. And I actually don't think there is a box. So, you know, you just have to learn to be more creative. And then in July, I'm going to speak to the other half of the federal judges in California. So, and get them to go visit a court in San Diego. So we're hoping that just by seeing these things, it does trigger, again, getting to the root causes of the problem. And like Ms. Dunn says, it's tragic that they have to end up in jail or charged with a federal offense to get the help they need. I'll have to say that our first graduate is from the Hilton Head area, Buford area. He, upon his graduation from drug court, he said that he just thanked the Lord that he had been indicted federally, because he was living in his car under a bridge with four children that he couldn't attempt to be part of their lives. And now he's reunited with his family. He actually had his charges dismissed, which was a first. I'd never seen it in federal court. I've prosecuted a number of people and always wanted to figure out afterwards how we could get the charge dismissed. But here we were able to get the charge dismissed because our U.S. attorney, Bill Nettles, is also thinks creatively. This fellow who graduated, who had been living in his car under a bridge, went on to become a firefighter, which was his dream. He's a firefighter down in Buford. And last week he was named Firefighter of the Year. So I hope to fly him to San Diego. He's Exhibit A.
And you know, I'm all for creativity. I'm all for trying new things. I think drug courts have done really good work. Some mental health courts have done really good work. But they do have a box. They have a box in that they still need to maintain basic due process of the court. And I have to say that I have seen, and I'm not talking about, absolutely not talking about this drug court, but I have seen drug courts in which the judges don't really have a clear sense that their job is to stay being the judge, where usual limitations on ex parte communication are just out the window. Where the judges are actually making medical decisions on behalf of the person in front of them, making a determination that you have to go off methadone maintenance, for instance, which is not a decision that a judge should be making. That is a medical decision.
But that's why we have counselors on board, and just to make sure, you know, that these are decisions I often would have to make. I know she's not talking about ours in particular,
no.
But I often would have to make whether or not there was a drug court involved or not, because there's plenty of people out there on bond and supervised release, and before the even with or without a drug court, probation officers are having to supervise these people and come to a judge and make a decision and have to make a call on these kind of issues. And that's where what I do and what I my probation office does in my direction is to consult with a doctor, get the person into treatment, get them screened properly so that the judge can make an informed decision along with medical providers. I wouldn't dream of trying to practice medicine,
And I'll just say, unfortunately, I think some of the people who function within these worlds, the line between where is the therapeutic relationship and where is the court relationship has really gotten blurred in such a way that it makes it very hard for people to navigate, and it makes it very hard for due process to still be real in those courts.
All right, we have time for one more question. We can try to squeeze you in too.
Oh, it's okay.
I'll try to be brief. Let me just say I'm excited I was invited. Thank you, panel, for being open and giving us insight. David, I'm a long way by your story, but I'm not surprised. Know Amy pretty well, and she's determined. And that's what it takes. It takes people in our community that are determined connect with men like you that really want to change and make the change happen. Judge, you're the same way. I see the sincerity and the heart and determination to change a broken system, because it's broken. I've always heard bad things about ACLU. I don't know why. You know, the great
minds. Just haven't met me before.
Exactly right. That's exactly right. So there again, and I speak from an ex-offender myself. So therefore, I understand how people can misjudge. But thank you for your insight, because you can see the passion, no doubt, is evident on the change of broken system also. Reverend Darby, no doubt the wisdom lies in you of many years of helping counsel and pastor and mentor and keeping our community safe. I'm excited to be a part of this initiative. I got several questions. We ain't got enough time. I want to give her respect and have it. Help me resolve in my heart and mind, because this is what I do. I used to sleep and do this also. I was locked up in 1987 because my mother committed suicide at 14. Got mad at God, got mad at my dad. Turned to drugs as a way of coping. Next thing you know, I'm locked up in the penitentiary with a 30-year sentence, voluntary manslaughter. Spent 15 years in South Carolina Department of Corrections, so trust me when I tell you, if anybody knows where the system's broke, I do. Okay? But for whatever reason, God had mercy and gave me another shot on it. The parole board gave me parole in 2002. And I made a heartfelt determination, as Amy and, matter of fact, I see Ashley sitting over here also, people in the community, to make a determined conscience, to make changes where changes are needed. That's what I've devoted my life to. So in the upstate, we've developed what we call evidence-based programming. So my first question was that, do y'all put a lot of weight in evidence-based programming? And if so, can you give me a quick definition of what evidence-based programming is to you? What is, when somebody says evidence-based programming, what does it define that for?
You know, it needs a program that has been tested to determine whether it works or not.
So, meaning not only does the process that you've tried, but you've been able to track it year after year after year?
Yes.
Praise God. It helps on the way. So that's what I believe. I believe we all have in common that we want to see evidence-based programming. I'd love to be a part of that initiative. We're starting your organization here in Charleston that's going to address those coming out of prisons in South Carolina. Whether you know it or not, Charleston's number four on the map, South Carolina, worst crime most people coming back to. We had 900 and some change released out of South Carolina last year that came back to Charleston. I don't even want to tell you how many fell through the cracks that didn't have any help. So Fresh Start is an organization we're starting here that I'm actually modeling that from one I started in the upstate called Jumpstart, that helps initiatives such as this to get communities more focused. I carry this around with me now as a reminder. See the laser beam? That's what we got to have, right? We've got to get laser beam focused as a community on what the core issues are. So I've gotten great comfort when I hear y'all say evidence-based programming over and over. At the same time, you've got a man sitting up there that's taking what Amy has implemented in the jails and says, hey guys, week after week after week, let's practice this change of character, change the mindset, change the heart set. No longer are you a dope dealer, you're a hope dealer, right?
That's right.
One last question. If we, say, as an organization, makes an initiative, and I got invited by Mayor Tecklenburg's wife, Sandy Tecklenburg, to come tonight, just to kind of hear what was going on in Charleston, because this stirs my heart to want to really address these needs. If we as a community, say I can rally and introduce y'all to some really prominent businessmen that I've met, would make a collaboration, because what I'm hearing is funding and resources is also an issue with the government as well as our local nonprofits. Am I correct when I say that? Can we make some kind of conscious effort in this initiative, how we can merge community businesses and businessmen as well as the government to pool our money and resources and hash out a evidence-based process for Charleston that will model not only making law-abiding taxpaying citizens in Charleston, but roll out a model across the country that will change what your goal is. Recidivism by 50% in 2030? Is that what the goal is?
Yeah.
That's pretty aggressive. And I can just tell you, I believe I can be accomplished. I know in our heart, in our little world, we've been doing in the upstate, the data and the evidence-based programming, we've taken it from 72% to 4.9% in the last 5 years. So I'm willing to put my hat in the ring and help with those initiatives. I just want to encourage y'all and thank you for what you're doing.
time for any more questions or comments. I just wanted to spend the last few minutes giving the panel an opportunity to provide us with any final comments.
Well, I think the library is an opportunity. The only thing I would encourage you to do, always when we have events like this, the conversation is simulated. Very often it's preaching to the choir. So if you can find some folk who might need a little, shall we say, enlightenment, and drag them along to occasions like this, I think that helps us to get down the road to real progress.
And I'm just going to use the bully pulpit. It's not exactly what we're here about, but it's something that I want everybody here to know about, which is that we have a long-term care facility for juveniles that's in Columbia that is in complete disarray. It's had four major compromises in security since last August. The state legislature is looking at this now, finally acknowledging that it's going on, but there is a real sense that the desire may be to just blame the kids. There's no indication that these kids are any worse than the kids who are usually there. But there's clearly a system that is broken. There's also a sense that the solution for those who just knee-jerk respond to it is to have the Department of Corrections come in and fix this. We're going to show everybody how to run jail. Those things could be very dangerous and set the juvenile system back a decade or so. So that I really encourage, if you have a possibility to participate in this conversation, to encourage the state to ask for help from people who know how to do it, to bring some experts in here on juvenile security, and to move this out of where we are to a place where our kids can be safe and can be rehabilitated. But we can easily make it worse rather than make it better.
Thank you, Ms. Megan, for having me. I want to thank Amy. I want to thank Amy for giving me this opportunity. I thank God that he put me and Amy together, that I got the opportunity to meet Amy, because right now life is beautiful. You know, I never thought that I'd be living this type of life, mentoring, doing speaking engagements. I just before I came here, I had to stop by Chief Mullen's office and talk to somebody from community outreach. They want me to start being a part of their program. I got another speaking engagement again at the Citadel next week, Tuesday. You know, I just got approved to start going into prisons, you know, and start talking to the guys back there, man. But I don't want to step back in prison by this. but all of it came possible, all of this came because of the program turning me and Amy. You know, and I just like to thank Amy for everything.
I'd like to thank Amy too.
I think Amy needs a round of applause.
Actually, we got a whole row of Turning Leaf people.
What is the show that they can pull up on Turning Leaf? Is Dateline?
It's MSNBC.
MSNBC. Yeah. How do you access
If you just
that?
Go to turningleafproject.com, we have a whole bunch of videos on there. Just testimonials from people like Anthony and Murphy, who are a graduate and a student, and David has a testimonial on there showing him working at the city before he got the Santa Cooper job. So
it's a great MSNBC special, so Amy deserves all of that and way more. She's worked tirelessly, gone into the jails herself, and done her programs, and while working at night as a waitress, I think it is, the community should be aware of what she's doing and fully support it, because this is Exhibit A right here, and he's a great man, and he's had courage to go out and do what he's doing, and to give him hope and to give him confidence and just to put our arm around him and say go forward, this is a great thing. So thanks, Amy. And I think we've made some progress in South Carolina. I think we're starting to make some progress around the country, and I just hope that everyone here is inspired to go out and do more. And everyone's invited to come to drug court. It will be tomorrow afternoon at 4:00 down at the federal courthouse. So please come.
Well, thank you all very much for coming. Thank you to the panelists for being willing to